Oh. You guys? Wow, thank you guys. I am just so overjoyed to be able to share God's word with you all today. Every time I get up here, I'm like, man, I feel like God hits me a little harder when I'm diving into the scriptures today. So today, we will be continuing our series in Acts. So go ahead and turn your Bibles with me to Acts chapter 9, 32 to 43. Acts chapter 9, 32 to 43. And so while you guys are turning there, I want to take us back into history, all the way back to February 10th, 1859. Because on this day in Oxford County, Ontario, Canada, Jonathan Goforth was born. And so out of the 11 children in the family, he was the seventh child that was born. And what was awesome was that his mom faithfully taught the scriptures to him. And by the time he was 7 years old, he received his first Bible. And by the time he got to 18 years old, he finally dedicated his life to Christ. Now, during high school, he would always just want to be a teacher or a politician, but his pastor had other plans for him. The pastor invited him to learn the scriptures in Latin and Greek. So as soon as he went into college, he had this burning desire to go out into the world on mission for the Lord. And this is where he actually received a book about the needs in China, where he actually prayed earnestly to God, saying, God, open a door so that I may go to China. And about 3 years later, on February of 1888, God sent him and his wife to China to be missionaries. And they ended up spending 46 years in the ministry on the mission field. And throughout that 46 years, they set up 31 mission stations, trained 61 native Chinese pastors, and brought to Christ about 13,000 people. Now, if you ask me, that is amazing. Like, how did he fit that all in his lifetime? Well, he was just an ordinary person, just like you, just like me. But the thing that stood out about him the most was that he believed. He firmly believed in the truth of the gospel, and he wanted to share that with the nations. He made it his life's mission to tell others about God. And through his obedience to God, it led to the faith of others. And I'm sharing this story with you all today because the big idea, the main thing in the scriptures that we're going to be reading today is that obedience to God leads to the faith of others. Obedience to God leads to the faith of others. So we're going to be looking at two stories today. And in both of these stories, we're going to see that obedience to God requires us to, one, go to those who need you. Two, requires us to have faith beyond experience. And number three, to do exactly what Jesus did. So point one, go to those who need you. Point two, requires us to have faith beyond experience. And three, to do exactly what Jesus did. So the background. We've been learning these past 2 weeks about how Paul was a ravager of the church. He was against the church. He was persecuting the church until he met Jesus and was transformed. And now he wasn't a persecutor anymore, but he was for the church. He was for Jesus. But now we're going to be shifting back into the story of Peter because we haven't heard about him in a while. So the scriptures point to what Peter has been doing. So verse 32, let's all go ahead and read. Now as Peter went here and there among them all, he came down also to the saints who lived at Lydda. So at this current time, people were coming to the cities. People were coming to Jerusalem from all towns and cities because they wanted to get ministered to. Because there was miraculous healings at this time, and they were coming because they were in need of God's presence. But that was in Jerusalem. Peter seems to be getting just a bigger picture of what is actually happening and going on here. He's like, okay, well, I can go to them instead of them coming here. And that is one of the first things to note in this passage, church. Peter saw more of a need to go out and proclaim the truth rather than just being in one city. Church, we can't just expect the world to walk in through those doors and want to learn about Jesus. We have to see a need for that to be done outside in our communities and go. Verse 33. Therefore, he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. And Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. And immediately he rose. He was expecting to go to the saints, the Christians that were in Lydda. However, he stumbles across a man who's been paralyzed. He had somewhere to be. He had somewhere to go. But yet, let's look at what he does. He doesn't just say, hey, bro, I'm kind of busy. Let me get your name, your number, your email, and I'm going to get back to you when I can. Like, no, he doesn't do that. But he stops. And he does the most important thing here. He sees this situation as an opportunity rather than an inconvenience. Church, what are some moments that we see in our daily lives as inconveniences rather than opportunities? For example, going to the grocery store, getting your hair cut, getting your oil changed. Anywhere you go, guess what? There's probably gonna be people. Is the first thing that comes to mind when you see those people, I'm gonna avoid eye contact so I don't get to talk to them? Or is our mindset, that is someone who I can share the gospel with today? Which one are you? But let's observe what Peter does when faced with this situation. He goes into this moment and he says, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. So Peter acknowledges that the fact that he can't do it, but Jesus can. And this is sounding familiar because he is remembering what actually happened back in the past when Jesus ran into a similar situation as well. So in Mark 2, 10 through 12, this is where Jesus was teaching to the people, and then all of a sudden, like, a guy gets lowered down right in front of him, and Jesus is looking up, and the people are like, heal him, Jesus, we don't want to reel him back up, please. And Jesus says, son, your sins are forgiven. Not everybody who was in the presence of Jesus was listening to gain something. They were listening to pinpoint and pick out what Jesus is saying wrong. The scribes in their heart said to themselves, who is this man? Who is this guy? Because only God can forgive sins. But yet, Jesus is like, in verse 10 of Mark 2, he says, but that you may know that the Son of God has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, go home. And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. Jesus made it undeniable that he was God. He went the harder route and he showed that he was God. But going back to Peter, Peter remembered this. Peter was like, this has happened before. Jesus can heal this paralytic right in front of me. So point number two, he had faith beyond experience. And he says, Jesus Christ heals you. Get up, make your bed. And Peter does exactly what Jesus did. And it says that Aeneas immediately rose up. Wow. Aeneas was a person who had been paralyzed for 8 years. He is now healed. And he is a literal walking testament of what God has done in his life. Have you ever been paralyzed or helpless before? I know about 2 weeks ago, if you guys paid attention to how I was walking, I was kind of limping. And you know, I wish I could tell you guys like a more cooler story about how a bear and I were wrestling and he put me in like an ankle lock and that's how I sprained my ankle. Like, I wish I could tell you guys that, but that's not the case. I actually fell into a hole. But hey, it's not just any hole, okay? It's like leaves covered the hole, playing disc golf, okay? So anyway, so I was handicapped. This was my first real injury. And at first, you know, I had the crutches because I always saw the kids with crutches in school. And I'm like, dude, this is cool. I wanted crutches. And it was like cool for the first night that was. But then I realized that everything started to actually take longer for me to do things. I depended on Kayla, God bless her heart, for everything. But Aeneas was paralyzed for 8 years. Imagine being paralyzed from the neck down. You had to depend on someone for everything, from eating, going to the restroom, moving. You depended on somebody else. And imagine living in a community that saw you. And then all of a sudden, he walks right past you. The man, Aeneas, is walking and no longer paralyzed. And people came to believe in the gospel because Aeneas' healing had no human explanation but God. Verse 35. And all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord. Do we know what just happened? As I was reading these scriptures, I completely just found myself overlooking this exact part. Church, do we pause and realize that when we read in the scriptures that many came to believe, how great that actually was? Do we realize the magnitude of what just happens when somebody gets saved from death onto life? Not only did one person come to believe, but all the residents of Lydda and Sharon came to believe. Are we joyful when we hear about people's salvation? That's story one. Whew. All right, let's get ready. Story two, let's go. All right, verse 36. It says, now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. She was full of good works and acts of charity. So Tabitha, Dorcas actually isn't kind of like a funny name, although it's like translated a little bit differently. But Dorcas is actually translated to dear, and this was an endearing term. She was full of good works and acts of charity. She knew the Lord, and she lived out her faith in good works and acts of charity. Verse 37, in those days, she became ill and died, and when they had washed her, they laid her up in an upper room. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, please come to us without delay. So the passing of Tabitha was felt throughout all the people. Like, the people were down, they were broken, they were sad. But a little after her passing, they hear in the next town over that Peter was there. The presence of God was moving. And that Aeneas was healed. And so out of their love for Tabitha, they send two men to go to Peter and be like, Peter, hey, come quickly. Hold up, wait a minute. Let's look at what Peter's thinking. He's like, dude, I literally just wanted to go to Lydda, to the saints, the believers in Lydda. But yeah, I meet this man Aeneas, he gets healed, and now people are coming to me. That's another situation. But Peter looks at this situation as an opportunity and not an inconvenience. So Peter, point one, goes to where he was needed. Verse 39. So Peter rose and went with them, and when he arrived, they took him to the upper room. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them. It was evident that people treasured Tabitha. She had such an impact to where people were grieving over her death, testifying of what she had done when she was still alive. And in the midst of all this, Peter was thinking and thinking and thinking. But in verse 40, Peter puts them all outside. Like, imagine that. You're at a funeral, and then the guest tells everybody to go outside. Like, that's kind of rude, right? But imagine that. He goes in Luke, he remembers in Luke chapter 8, 49 through 56, that Jesus raised a little girl from the dead, and Jesus emptied the room and only allowed Peter, James, John, and the father and the mother of the little girl that passed away to be in the room. And so once again, Peter is remembering what Jesus did. And point two, having faith beyond experience, he depended on Jesus and what Jesus had done. And point three, he did exactly what Jesus did. And he knelt down and prayed. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes. And when she saw Peter, she sat up. When he says, Tabitha, arise, in the Aramaic language, it is actually one syllable off of what Jesus said when he rose that little girl from the dead. Peter followed Jesus in his example to the T, right there. Guys, when met with situations, do you know what it means to follow Jesus? Do you follow in his footsteps? Do you love what he loves, and do you hate what he hates? Verse 41, and he gave her his hand and raised her up. Then calling the saints and the widows, he presented her alive, and it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Once again, we see here that through Peter's obedience, many came to know the Lord. And in verse 43, it ends with, and he stayed in Joppa for many days with one Simon, a tanner. Now, if you were in the culture and you were Jewish at this time, you looked on as a tanner as an unclean occupation because they had to touch dead animals. And if you were a devout Jew, you wouldn't go anywhere near that. But Peter didn't care. He's breaking boundaries. And we'll get to learn about that more next week in chapter 10. But now that we've gone through both of these stories, what could we learn? What can we learn? So as I was wrestling with the text, as I was reading the text, I came to three reflections. Three reflections that I have for us today, church. Reflection number one, are you willing to let God lead you? Are you willing to let God lead you? Because at the beginning of the passage, Peter was set on going to the Christians in Lydda. He wanted to build them up, encourage them, but we see that he was directed in multiple ways. And he saw these situations not as inconveniences, but as opportunities. opportunities to share the gospel. I remember one time during my time at Bible college, I was sitting at a nightly conference for the night session, and it was missions conference, so we focused on missions. And Ed Stetzer was preaching that night, and while he was preaching, he asked everybody to just close their eyes in the middle of his sermon. And so everybody closed their eyes, and he said, follow, say what I say, repeat after me. And he said the words, God, I will follow you wherever you lead me. God, I will follow you wherever you lead me. And he told us to repeat that over and over again for a little bit. And you know, I was peeking around and I was seeing who was actually doing it, and people were actually doing it. And I'm like, okay, I guess I will too. So, you know, I closed my eyes and I started to think, God, this is a dangerous prayer that Ed Stetzer is leading us through. This is dangerous. And quite frankly, God, I don't know if I can pray that prayer. And then it hit me. I've already trusted, put my faith and trust, and I believe in the Lord Jesus that he would lead me into eternity. Why is it so hard for me to believe and trust him in my everyday-to-day life? Why is it so hard? Well, some of us, I would like to ask the question, are you willing to go where God leads you? Are you willing to share the gospel wherever he leads you? Well, some of us may say, well, I'm not smart enough. I can't answer big questions. I don't have that calling. I'm seriously not qualified. Well, if anybody's not qualified to share the gospel, it might be Peter. Because if we really look at it, who is Peter? Peter was a fisherman. He didn't have an educational background. He worked with his hands, not his head. That's why he was impulsive. He didn't think things through. He was hot-headed. He is known for denying Jesus 3 times. But yet God uses him. So likewise, God can absolutely use you as well. It doesn't matter, regardless of your past and what you've done, God can use you. And this may come as a shocker to some of us, but God's not surprised that we're imperfect. He knows that. But are you willing to be used by God? And going back to Missions Conference, Ed Stetzer ended with this quote. Put your yes on the table and let God put it on the map. Put your yes on the table and God will put it on the map. Brothers and sisters, is your yes on the table? Is it on the table? Reflection number 2. Do you live like you believe the gospel? Do you believe? For example, if I wholeheartedly believed an apple a day will keep the doctor away, if I believe that, I would eat an apple a day. But do you believe in the gospel? Like, it sounds like a no-brainer question for me asking you that, but do you? If we believe in the gospel, it should lead us to action. Like Tabitha, she firmly believed in the gospel, and it led her to faith and good works of charity. She knew the truth of the gospel truth, and others came to know God's love through it. So first and foremost, if I were to ask you, what is the gospel? I would probably say the majority of us would start quoting John 3:16. So I have it on the screen for us, so let's all, as a congregation, read that together. For God so loved the world, he sent his one and only Son. And whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. That's such a beautiful verse. Such a beautiful verse. A verse that many come to know only on paper, but not in their lives. Because if we truly believed what this verse really said, we can draw out two conclusions from it. Number one, God's unconditional love is reflected through Jesus Christ, that he sent his one and only son to die on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. He did that. We can draw that from the passage. The second thing that we can actually draw from this passage is the result of our response to God's love. If we truly believe what John 3:16 says, we have to believe in two realities. If you believe, you're going to heaven. If you don't believe, where do they go? Not everybody is going to go to the same place. Not everyone's going to be there. So what do we do if we know this truth? How are we to live knowing this truth? And I'm going to admit to you guys, I'm not perfect either. I have my flaws, and they're big flaws. But about a year and a half ago, Kayla and I, we were going to the pet store because our puppy needed food. So early in the morning, we got up, we were running our errands, we got dog food, and on the way back, we noticed that we forgot to feed our dog because we were out of dog food. And so we were like, hey, we got free samples from the pet store. Why don't we go there? Why don't we give him some food right now? That's a great idea. Actually, halfway through our trip going home, he threw up. And we were like, oh my goodness. It started to stink, and we were like, okay, we got to get out of here. We got to go fast. And so we stopped at the nearest gas station, but we failed to realize where we were actually at. We noticed that we weren't in the best of neighborhoods, but yet we needed to clean the car. And so Kayla and I made a decision, hey, you clean the car, I get the gas, ready, set, go. So we stopped. She started cleaning, entered my credit card in, and, you know, entered the PIN and whatnot, and then reached for the gas handle. And as I was reaching for the gas handle, a voice shouted out to me, hey, man, I got that. I looked over, and not to judge, but he seems like he was a less fortunate brother. And I said, no, it's okay. It's okay. No, I got it. It's okay. Thank you, though. He goes, no. I insist. Like, I do this for everybody. I'm here. You don't even have to pay me. Oh, no, it's okay. Like, no worries. Like, I got it. And then there was a pause. And in this pause, I heard a voice. And that voice said to me, tell him about me. Tell him about me. And I was thinking to myself, you know what? I am probably not in the right neighborhood. I have my wife, my puppy, and it's cold outside. And throughout this whole moment, this whole pause, I came to the conclusion, no. And as soon as I said no, this man says, God is good, man. God is good. And I responded back to him, yeah, man, God is good. Yeah, you know, it's cold outside and whatnot, but, you know, God keeps us warm. Amen. He's like, yep, sure does. And then he went out to the next person in line, and he helped them. And Kayla and I, we were finally done at this point. I'm like, I got to get out of here. I, like, booked it home. And there was a silence in the car. Like Kayla knew there was something that was bothering me at this point. And she goes, what's bothering you? And all I could remember at this point was uncontrollable weeping from my end. I could not stop crying. And I remember saying to Kayla, I'm so disappointed in myself. I have not heard God in so long. And when I finally hear him, he tells me to tell him, tell this man about the gospel, and I said no. And when I said no, this man says, God is good. Kayla, I did not care where he went in eternity. I didn't care if this man went to hell. If I truly cared about this man's salvation, I would have told him about God. The gospel is the power to save those from eternal darkness into the light. Treat it as such. If you saw your brother, your sister, your mother, father, grandma, grandpa running towards a cliff, would you tell them to stop? Would you save them? If there were people you know that don't know about Jesus and they were headed towards a cliff with no return, would you tell them the gospel? Would you tell them about God? Reflection number three, where can you reflect God? The simple answer, it is where you're placed right now. Your schools, your neighborhood, at the gym, your community centers, at your job. Like, I've been fortunate enough to be able to just be around brothers and sisters in the faith and working with them Monday through Sunday. It's been a joy, but the thing that I miss the most is working with those who do not believe in God. And you guys are probably asking me, like, why? Like, are you kidding me? I wish my coworkers knew about God. That would solve all my problems. But let me ask you this. Does a flashlight shine brighter in the day or at night? When you're around others who don't believe in God, you are the example of Christ in their life. You are the light in the darkness. You just have to turn it on. For example, I know a guy who used to work at an airport. And as he was working in the airport, he noticed that the people he was working around with are different from him. They didn't know about God. And so he steps out in faith, no matter if they made fun of him or not. He started a Bible study. Funny enough, about 10 to 15 people showed up. He didn't expect that. But he wouldn't have seen God working if he didn't step out in faith. You never know how God will show up and work. It's not a matter of how you can step out in faith. It's a matter of when do you step out in faith? Obedience to God leads to the faith of others. Obedience to God leads you to strengthen your relationship with God as well. I'm not saying that we're going to go out from here and do miracles like Peter. That's not exactly what I'm saying. All I'm saying is that you can obey God right here and right now. All you have to do is just look a little bit closer at the people around you. Because someone was obedient to God, and it led to your faith in Jesus. How is your obedience leading others to God? How is your obedience leading others to God? And I'm going to close with this hymn as a prayer for us. So let's all bow our heads and pray. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows, for the joy he bestows, are for them who will trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says, we will do. Where he sends, we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Amen.